survivors, and welcome to Survivor's Guild, the only channel that determines your odds of surviving 2009's modern take on a classic slasher, Sorority Row, as requested by Polar Project. So stay tuned till the end for your survival stats. I'm your sharp-dressed slasher-turned-horror host, GhostFake, and today we are taking a look at 2009's nonsensical slasher, Sorority Row, which I'm pretty sure knows exactly what it is. But first, go ahead and stab that like button and shoot that subscribe button in the mouth with a flare. And go ahead and hit that share button to let all your sorority sisters know that you know what they did. And feel free to check out patreon.com/survivorsguild. For just $1 a month, you can help us here at Survivor's Guild cover up that murder. Ooh, maybe I shouldn't make that joke. Now I hope you like finding out that everyone in your life is the biggest piece of sh** that would cover up your accidental death in a heartbeat, and then when everyone involved starts dying, they blame you, because this movie is getting spoiled. Sorority Row, written by Josh Stolberg, Pete Goldfinger, and Mark Rosman, and directed by Stewart Hendler, starring Briana Evigan, Rumer Willis, Jamie Chung, Leah Pipes, Margo Harshman, Julian Morris, and Carrie Fisher. Sorority Row is a very loose remake of 1982's The House on Sorority Row, but aside from a prank gone wrong, it seems to bear little resemblance to that movie, and turns out to just be an excuse to make a schlocky slasher. It's hard to tell if this is a good movie or not, and it's got decent kills, but with the most generic killer and the most ridiculous, albeit creative, murder weapon. Toss that in with the dumbest and most unlikable characters who constantly one-up themselves and each other in their pursuit to become and a storyline so ridiculous I'm surprised it didn't get thrown out immediately. Toss in rapid-fire jokes and gratuitous nudity and low-cut shirts, and you've got a living example of this meme. We open up to a ridiculous house party at the Theta Pi sorority, where we start getting introduced to characters as the camera pans around the chaos. We get introduced to Cassidy, Chugs, House Mother Mrs. Crenshaw, Ellie, Jessica, and eventually Claire. We learn from our mains that they are kicking off their senior year in college, and they start the toast by showing off what particular brand of asshole they are.
Claire, I like being your friend because it makes me multicultural without having to do anything.
I love you, Jessica, because you make being a an art form.
Jessica grabs the laptop and they gather around it to see a live video of Chugs' brother Garrett making out with Megan, one of their sorority sisters. We here learn that Jessica and Megan planned a prank to get Garrett back for cheating on her, albeit after she cheated on him, wherein Claire gave pills to Garrett to put in Megan's drink.
Come on, review sex isn't that bad. You get laid and you get a good night's sleep.
Which were harmless to Megan, but they were to make Garrett think that he accidentally killed her. Garrett freaks out and Chugs gives him the keys to bring the SUV around while the girls chat with Megan.
No, I'm not okay. I have fake puke all over my $800 silk sheets.
They hear Garrett honk the horn when he pulls up in the vehicle. They leave with Megan's body and convince Garrett to head to the hospital. But in reality, Claire is driving them to the mines as part of this over-the-top prank, eventually convincing Garrett that hiding the body is the only way to get around the possible punishment for having drugs on the campus, and that this way they can make everything go away. They arrive at the mines, and while Garrett is busy puking, Megan sets up her phone to film it, while the rest of them casually talk about dismembering the body and stabbing it in the chest so that the body doesn't float to the surface if there is water at the bottom of the mineshaft. And while everyone wanders around to find sharp rocks with which to dismember the body, Garrett grabs a tire iron and stabs Megan in the chest while no one is paying attention. Cassidy uses her coat to try to stop the bleeding, but Megan is backfired into the meat bank at deposit number one. Jessica pitches to them that they should hide the body to avoid bringing unnecessary controversy onto their families. They come to an agreement, kind of, some more reluctant than others, and when Cassidy objects and attempts to call the police, Garrett threatens her, and the others threaten to blame her in order to keep it quiet. The girls dump the body into the mineshaft, wrapped up in Cassidy's bloody jacket, while Cassidy was trying to get a signal, and then take an oath of silence.
Honor, secrecy, and solidarity.
Cut to 8 months later, at their graduation, Cassidy's boyfriend Andy is giving his valedictorian speech, and we find out that Cassidy has disassociated from her sisters. Naturally, the threat of blaming murder on someone tends to have that effect. And later, they attend a graduation celebration at her ex-sorority. And during the Theta Pi celebration, whilst Jessica is in the middle of a toast to their missing sister Megan, Ellie screams and faints when she thinks she sees her. Later, she comes to, only to find out that that was Megan's younger sister, Maggie. What the hell? Isn't Maggie short for Megan? Does this family only have one name? Someone get that family a baby name book.
Nice to meet you guys.
You too.
Friend me on Facebook, I'll totally confirm.
And after she leaves, Kyle and Mickey enter the room looking to party, and Jessica sends them to the cellar for decorations. And when Chugs goes to leave to score oxys from her shrink, the sisters all receive a text at the same time from an unknown number that contains a picture of the tire iron that was used to kill Megan. The sisters assume it's some sort of sick joke from Garrett, who has not dealt with the whole murder prank very well. Come on, Garrett, it's just a joke. And the sisters delete the message and move on with the party. Cassidy gets roped into helping with the setup in spite of her plans to leave with Andy to his family's property. So she calls Andy and lets him know she'll be leaving a little bit late. Cassidy later attends a gift-giving ceremony held by their house mother, Mrs. Crenshaw, who gives everyone a ceremonial bracelet that I'm only mentioning because it will come into play later. Cut over to Chugs, who has arrived at her therapist's house, whom she finds cuffed to his bed. He explains that his last session ended abruptly, and he bribes her with prescription meds to finish it. She heads to the bathroom to freshen up, while Dr. Rosenberg holds tight, and he can hear someone coming his way. He calls out to them, but gets no response, so he unlocks the cuffs and gets out of the bed, only to have a modified tire iron thrown at him from a robed figure, nailing him in the head and nailing him into the meat bank at deposit number 2. Meanwhile, Chugs calls her sisters to let them know that she'll be late and heads back out to satisfy Dr. Rosenberg. And when she can't find him, she lays down on the couch and chugs wine until the killer slams the bottle into her throat, shoving it into her esophagus. And hits it with his tire iron, breaking the glass in her throat, and chugging her into the meat bank at deposit number 3. Cut over to Jessica, who is meeting with Senator Tyson, her boyfriend Kyle's dad, who has a heart-to-heart with her, letting her know that he won't have his political career thwarted by a girl he knows nothing about, which is only as important as it further motivates Jessica to keep any bad press from surfacing. Cut over to the gratuitous shower scene.
Fine, but if you wanted to see perfect, all you had to do was ask.
What?
And once all the girls leave, except for this girl, apparently named Joanna, the killer enters the showers and washes Joanna into the meat bank at deposit number 4. Cut to later, and elsewhere, when Ellie is in the basement looking for something, and finds Cassidy's old coat that Megan was dropped in the mineshaft with, as well as Kyle, taking the form of a red herring. And as the party begins, Ellie lets her sisters know about the coat, and all of a sudden, her sisters want to be rational.
Nobody is dead, Ellie. Well, Megan.
They try to call Chugs, but she doesn't answer, for obvious reasons.
Hi, it's Chugs. Leave a message after the...
Chugs, we need to know where your brother is, and we need to know now.
But they are still convinced that Garrett is the culprit, and ultimately decide to continue with the party and wait it out. With the party going full force and the girls on edge, Claire decides it's a good time to dump Mickey, who then proceeds to hit on every other girl he sees, since it's graduation night.
Mickey, if you touch me again, kill you.
Until he finds a couple of underclass girls who are trying to climb the scaffolding to break into the party. He offers to trade some passes for some flashes, but he comes off too sleazy and the girls pass on him.
We're gonna pass.
No, you need to pass.
Well, you're just a little too creepy.
Yeah, and you're not real hot either.
That's not very nice.
And shortly after, he notices Ellie upstairs and he heads up there to try to convince her not to tell Claire that he hit on her. But upstairs, he gets hit on by the cloaked killer, breaking his leg. And when he tries to climb down the dumbwaiter, the killer uses his modified tire iron to saw into him, sawing Mickey into the meat bank at deposit number 5. Ellie sees the murder happen and then goes to warn the sisters, but when Ellie, who is too panicked to talk, doesn't talk, Cassidy and Jessica go to see what the problem is and discover Mickey's dead body. They take note of the pimped out tire iron before they get a text, which turns out to be the video taken the night Megan died, implicating all of them, along with a text telling them to meet where they killed Megan, and that the video will be sent to the police if they don't show up. Cassidy tells Andy to go ahead and head to his parents' house and that she'll meet him there tomorrow because she has something that she needs to take care of tonight. The surviving sisters get into the car and head to the mine, and they run into Maggie, who decided to come to the party anyway, and lets Jessica know that her dead sister always hated her.
Oh, by the way, my sister hated you. Peace.
They arrive at the mine where they find Garrett, who has used some broken mirror to cut up his wrists. And when he lunges at the sisters, Jessica drives her SUV into him, knocking him to the ground, but not depositing him. They find his phone and discover that he received the same texts that they did, which means that he probably wasn't the one sending them, aside from the fact that he's gone crazy, but never mind that. We don't have time for speculation. The sisters lower Cassidy into the mine using a chain, until Cassidy's fat ass breaks the chain. She comes to only to find Megan is missing, feel-good movie of the year 2011, and a message on the wall that says Theta Pi must die. Cut back to the sorority house where everyone has moved on to the after party, and while Claire attempts to turn off the bubble bath broken hot tub, the surviving sisters get an update from Chugs that she's going to miss the party because she's dead. Sad face. But just then, Claire slams into the glass door trying to get in, and before they can get her, she is dragged into the bubbles in the backyard, which she disappears into. Cassidy heads out to save her, and the flare gun Claire had goes off. Cassidy approaches the flare and finds Claire having a flare shot into her mouth, flaring Claire into the meat bank at deposit number 6. Jessica continues her search for Kyle and finds Maggie in her bed, who claims to have slept with Kyle. They fight it out until Cassidy breaks it up, and the group keeps silent as they hear someone approaching, and Jessica grabs a well-placed fire axe and heads over to head them off. It turns out to be Mrs. Crenshaw with a shotgun, who dodges the axe and hits Jessica in the face. Mrs. Crenshaw tells her that she saw what she did, and Jessica admits to them killing Megan.
I saw what you did.
We didn't mean to kill Megan.
Kill Megan? I was talking about trashing my house.
But Mrs. Crenshaw was referring to them trashing the house. Cassidy says they'll explain later and that they are not sure Megan is actually dead. Jessica comes clean that she told Kyle about Megan, and Mrs. Crenshaw tells them to hide in Jessica's room while she goes and blasts the perpetrator in the face. They hear a shotgun blast, and Maggie, who has just now heard that her sister might not be dead, gets upset knowing that her sister might now actually be dead, and leaves the room to find out. Cut over to Mrs. Crenshaw, who is blowing apart the kitchen, when the killer throws his tire iron into the fridge next to her, and then pushes her into it, impaling Mrs. Crenshaw into the meat bank at deposit number 7. Cut over to Maggie, who's confronted by the killer before the killer throws a Molotov cocktail at her, igniting the house. We then cut over to Cassidy and Jessica, who run into Kyle, in a graduation gown, who is red herring all over the place, and attacks the girls before they finally get away and hide in a bathroom, while Kyle hunts for them. They find Megan's body hiding in the shower, all dead and stuff.
Oh, she looks terrible.
Which is going to re-crush her sister all over again. There is nothing worse than finding out your sister died. Twice. Kyle sends his axe handle through the door, knocking out Jessica, and Cassidy makes a break for her when his axe gets stuck in the doorframe. He axes the axe and tackles the cast, letting her know that if this gets out, it'll ruin his dad's political potential. But just then, Kyle gets hit in the head with an axe, axing him into the meat bank at deposit number 8. And now with the dead herring gone, snuffed out by Cassidy's boyfriend Andy, who showed up to save the day, Jessica comes to, and Cassidy comes to the realization that Andy has been the killer all along, and he would have gotten away with it if it weren't for this movie's unreasonable runtime. Jessica begins explaining that it shouldn't be too hard to clean up this mess and that Andy can count on them to keep his secret safe, before Andy counts her into the meat bank at deposit number 9.
That girl really needs to learn to keep her mouth shut.
Andy comes clean that he knows about Megan because Ellie told him, and that he did all this to help Cassidy escape this terrible sorority. And he tells Cassidy that now they have to kill Ellie, so that no one else finds out. And once she's dead, Cassidy will be in the clear. She plays along, and the two of them split up. She goes to warn Ellie, and the two of them get cornered by Andy, who is upset that Cassidy doesn't appreciate what he's done for her. He attacks Cassidy, and she knocks him down.
Just myself, I took a greyhound out of town.
Yeah, good one.
On her way out of the house, she finds Maggie screaming for help. She stops to help her, telling her that she wasn't there for her sister, but she's here now for her. But then Andy shows up to stoke the fire, and he begins throwing a tire iron at her, trying to kill her. But when his tool gets stuck in a hole in the floor, Cassidy tosses a chair at him as a distraction. And after he ducks and comes back up, she is nowhere to be found. She pops up next to him and knocks him out, and continues trying to help Maggie. But Andy gets back up and attacks Cassidy, sending Cassidy falling through the floor. But the bracelet that Mrs. Crenshaw gave them gets caught on a piece of wood and keeps Cassidy from falling into the fire. And when Andy goes to finish her, Ellie pops up behind him and shoots him in the chest with a shotgun. And the floor underneath him collapses, sending him into the inferno and into the meat bank at deposit number 10. Ellie and Maggie then help Cassidy up, and the three of them walk out of the flaming structure. Cut to 15 months later, Theta Pi is back up and rushing, with Maggie as one of the sisters, and the gardeners are working hard on the garden when one of them is revealed to be Garrett, and the movie ends. So now, to find out, what are your odds of suffering survivor's guilt? This is where we take a look at our main characters and the death that surrounds them to determine your odds of surviving this movie.
First and foremost, hi, what's up? I'm happy to be here. I love you, GhostFake. I'm a big ass fan. So this just feels right. If I could talk about how much I love you all day, but I'm not gonna do that, specifically because you asked me to do something else. So I'm just gonna do that because I feel like if I do what you say, you're gonna like me, and that's like my whole game. So first off, in the meat bank, we got Megan, who can wear the shit out of that white little number, but can't pull a prank to save her life. Literally, because she's not alive anymore. Megan is dead. Another Megan is missing. Up next, if you thought that you were a master of sex, you thought you knew how to throw it down, how to get up in it, sit down, you're wrong. You ain't got shit on Dr. Rosenberg. My man's died for the kink. I get down, but like, I'm not gonna die for it. That's a level of dedication I'm just not sexy enough for. So Dr. Rosenberg, we salute you, AC/DC. At deposit number 3, Chugs stays true to her name and proves that she can just outdrink and outsuck anyone underneath a table. Shit, I have a table.
Call me.
Joanna, arguably the most important character in this whole movie, she takes the crown at number 4. I mean, would it even be Sorority Row without Joanna? Yes, 1000% yes. Who are you? Mean Girls. She doesn't even go here. She dies and we don't even miss her. That said, thank you for showing me your like forever. Like, I could just look at your now because you did it in this movie. That's just a cool girl thing to do. Baller. Now, how do you heal a broken heart? Well, for starters, you don't die like Mickey, who wasn't even doing heartbreak the right way. Let me tell you something, Mickey, a real man, we get dumped and then like we stop showering. You just lay on your bedroom floor and face down, just tapping on the floor, making up songs. You don't get stuck in a dumb waiter shaft, then just get stabbed in the throat over it. So that way you can cover your eyes, Mickey, you f*** you, Mickey. Oh, Mickey, you're so whack. I don't even glad that you died.
That's not very nice.
Don't even blow my mind. At number 6, we got Sweet Sweet Claire, the only attempt that this movie had to be ethnically inclusive. And when she dies, it isn't even like the cute bubbles that she was around with. She just gets a flare to the mouth and real talk, I'd still hit though. At number 7, we got Mrs. Crenshaw, who proves that just teachers don't get paid enough for watching your stupid ass kids. Can we call her a teacher? I mean, she's a house mother. That's in the world, right? I feel like she enters the conversation. Anyway, yeah, dead as shit now. Ash never made that mistake with his boomstick, Kyle, who not only has an unfortunate name, but also has the ball-sucking, daddy-loving tendencies that come along with it. Like that one episode of Aqua Teen Hunger Force where the guy's like, my dad owns a dealership.
Somebody be doing some meat slapping tonight.
Hey, my dad owns a dealership. Dude, she was eyeing me.
All right, no cap. There's some embarrassing kills on this list. But for your last words to be so off.
Guess your boyfriend's not here to protect you, huh?
Then you catch an axe to the head? That's insult to injury. Jessica is next, and thank God for that. Did anyone watch Sorority Row and be like, no, she'll make it out alive? What are you, new? It is October. Get your spooky cred up. And lastly, we got Andy, the central killer of Sorority Row, coming in for that number 10 spot. Part of me feels bad for homie. He was just trying to have his girls back. Some people show love in crazy ways. Andy is proof of that. That said, homie catches bullets to the chest and then just falls right into the fire. Motherfucker's catching a nice sear in the meat bank and Hey, but it ain't all bad. We got 4 whole people surviving this thing. So shout outs to Cassidy, Ellie, Maggie, and Garrett. So, you know, a win for shared trauma.
Which means that out of a total of 14 characters, only 4 survive, giving you a 28.5% chance of surviving this movie. Given those odds, how many Theta Pi pranks can you survive? Let me know in the comments below. And if this is your first time on my channel, feel free to check out some of my other videos. And special thanks to all my patrons, Chris D, Sackhead Ed, Bubba T, Max H, Video Creep, Poppy Julio, Valentina P, Mintrix, Brady D, Matthew, Vids for You, Mr. Nightmare Fuel, Maxwell the Kaiju Man, Lobotomite, and Whiskey. Thank you guys so much for bearing with me. I seriously appreciate it. And as always, guys, thanks and don't die.